This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Good morning and welcome to Guardian Radio AM. Today is Tuesday, November 1st, and it's a little after 11 o'clock in the morning. Once again, this is C.A. Newry, and I shall be your host for the day as we speak about culture, as we speak about what we should be doing again for our 50th Independence Day celebration. And in order to have that conversation, in order to assist me with that conversation, we have one of the premier storytellers in the Bahamas, one of the premier poets in the Bahamas, who his entire life is involved in creating and crafting poetry and stories that is based on the culture of the Bahamas. So I brought her in just so we can have a chat about what she's anticipating, what she's doing, and to make sure that people are aware of her talent. And I'm kind of excited because these poetry moves Bahamians. And in fact, she's more popular on social media where people forward her work, but nobody knows who she is. So without further ado, I shall introduce you to Miss Lady, and that's her pen name, Lady Miller. And welcome to Guardian Radio in the Morning, Miss Miller.
Thank you very much, Mr. Newry. It's a pleasure to be here this morning.
Actually, the pleasure is mine. Anyone who knows me knows that I love culture. I immerse myself in Bahamiana and knowing and experiencing poetry, the Bahamian stories, the music, the folklore, and everything like that. So then the idea that I got you on the show. Mm-hmm. So people can hear and experience what you do, especially in preempting the country's 50th Independence Day celebration, to let the powers that be know that you are out here and that you write and that you craft poems based on such things. I'm excited for that, and I want to thank you for coming on.
Well, you're quite welcome. Listen, that's my thing. I enjoy... I love, first of all, being a Bahamian. As you can see, I come in all my colors.
Yes.
I got my matching person hat. I'm just a patriotic Bahamian, Bahamian and proud.
I see that.
100%.
I see that.
You know, mixing up in there. And I love my culture. I love everything about being a Bahamian. You understand? It's just embedded in me. I remember one time my daughter told me when she was a teenager, she said, "Mommy, I'm going to go away and go to school and go to college, and I'm going to make a lot of money. When I make a lot of money, I'm going to make sure I'm get settled and I'm going to stay in the States." She won't go to the States. Mm-hmm. "So I'm coming back for you and daddy." I said, hold on, what do you mean you come back for me? Me and your dad, you must come back for your daddy. But as for me, I ain't going nowhere. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't mind go visiting foreign for a couple of days, but I got to come back here. This is my home. She said, "But mommy, the ship is sinking." Mm-hmm. I said, "Listen, yeah, sweetie, I getting down with this ship." Mm-hmm. You understand? I ain't got nowhere to go. This is my home. You understand?
And this is one of the things that I'm always impressed with you, your passion and your desire to celebrate we self.
Yes.
Right? And I want my listening audience to experience that. And that's one of the reasons that I invited you on, because I know you're going to bring one or two pieces for me to read for the audience. But before I start, I want to know about you. Mm-hmm. Why do you write? When did you start writing?
Well, why do I write and when do I write? I write because it offers me a secret place. A place where there's peace and there's joy and there's love, there's ambience. Every time I put pen to paper, well, these days you can type it in, I go into a place, a secret place where my father and I are. God is my father. I call him daddy.
I understand.
Yeah, so he's the one actually who gives me the words to these pieces. I cannot take any glory in that regard. You know, sometimes when he give me the words, I be there laughing because I'm just picturing the whole thing, you know, laughing. Mm-hmm. But he's given me these. And I write based on my life experience. Mm-hmm. I can write on any topic, anything. I can sit here and write something even about you, just sitting right here. Mm-hmm. It's just a gift that I get. I can write on anything in the world, the good, the bad, and the ugly. And the thing is with me, I do not fear sharing the good, the bad, or the ugly because I'm free, you understand?
And that's good. And I see that a number of your poems have a theme. Mm-hmm. They're always about the Bahamas, the celebration of the Bahamas, you know. Mm-hmm. I have read one or two religious ones also. And an inspiration, because I know you're even a motivational speaker in your private life, in terms of your trade and in terms of what you do. So and I see that you, I'm sorry, you incorporate all of that in order to pursue your poetry.
Yes, and what I do is based on what I am feeling or what I'm experiencing. I just put pen to paper, and it's amazing how it comes out. Not only that, the words comes for me to write, but normally they end up being in rhyming form, and also with the Bahamian dialect. I can write, you know, the Queen's English as well, but my preference is always with the dialect, and even when I recite it. And your listeners will be able to hear, you know, when I recite one of them, like, wow, I see she's saying. Filled with the dialect.
I understand. I always compare your writing to a Pat Ramming and a what a German name from who do I say we self Catlin
James Catlin.
Their poetry embraces a Bahamian dialect.
Yes,
right?
Yes.
And I find that your poetry is very similar.
Would you believe it? When I was a very little girl, I saw or I heard one of what
James
his name
Catlin?
Is? Yes.
Okay.
Yes, his pieces. I we do plays and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And I was fascinated. I said, wow, you know, a little girl didn't realize that was the gift in me, you understand, recognizing his gift. I said, wow, I could do that too. You know, mm-hmm. I remember myself saying that I could do that, you know. And then I remember I also auditioned to one of his pieces, and he one of his upcoming plays that he had, and he would have picked me to be a part of it. But at the time I had just had my baby and I was mm-hmm. breastfeeding her. Mm-hmm. So he told me, okay, whenever she comes, you know, off of breastfeeding, please come back to me. But of course my life
changed.
Yeah, I was a new mother, first mother, mm-hmm. first of all. And yeah, life happened, and I never did get to go back to him. And then you also mentioned the other gentleman.
Was it Pat Ramming?
Yes. Yeah, so these are individuals that I would have seen through the course of my life as a child. And something in me would click, say, wow, I could do that. You know, yeah, I have the same thing inside of me. Not knowing that, you know, some 30, 40 years later, here I am with the same gift and the same talent that God has blessed them with, I too have.
And this is one of the things we're trying to do here at Guardian, to make room and make space for Bahamians who appreciate the country, the culture, the climate, and give them the avenue to share. Mm-hmm. Right, and I want you to start getting ready to read one of your poems, because I want people to experience that. But where were you born? Were you born in Nassau, or were you born on Family Island?
Yes, born, raised, bred right here in Nassau, Bahamas. Now my roots stem on both sides to Auckland's. Mm-hmm. My grandmother is from Pompey Bay, Auckland's. The Hannahs, the Tynes, the Hasties. I'm related to those. All the 80 Hannah and those are my peeps. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, on my father's side, I'm from the Mosses. And the Moss came from Snuggon, Auckland's. Yes.
So you're an Auckland's woman through and through.
All around. And would you believe I haven't been there as yet? Shame on me.
A number of Auckland's Islanders have yet to dawn and visit the island. So that's something we need to coming home.
Yeah, man. We need to start doing some quick ferries to go to these places. See, a lot of people so love Nassau. But if you do a quick ferry that goes there, you know, mm-hmm. brings you back, mm-hmm. time is that night or that morning, the next morning, mm-hmm. me and mine, we just do want to go there and be stuck there. You understand?
You're a city woman.
Yeah. But no, I actually prefer the island life.
I understand. Okay, but
most people are city people. They can't do it without the internet and all that stuff.
I understand.
It's not having jitters.
Without further ado, I want you to prepare that poem for me and say what it's about and go ahead.
Okay, this one is entitled Leap of Faith. I don't have it by heart. I'm going to read this one. But when I share the next one, it'll be from heart. And you'll be able to notice the difference when I get it from heart. I'll have a leap of faith. Father, go before me as I take this jump. Move them stumbling blocks away from me, the prickled trees and the bumps. I know what's ahead of me, but your words say that I must step out. Even though fair talking to me, I'm going to grip my throat. You said inside your word that I simply must believe, never doubting what you say. just in faith I have to receive. So here I go there, Father, looking at my present state. I'm going to put my trust in you as I take this leap of faith. So it's just like a quick prayer that I was talking to God.
And prayer is important.
Yes.
And I would like to know, like, for your poems, where would you have performed in general?
Many places. Oh, wow. I've been in the schools. I've performed to many weddings and stuff like that. Funerals.
Mm-hmm.
Different functions. There are some functions where the government had to offer these accolades to individuals, you know, these ceremonies. Different places where there's normally crowds. I've performed at parties as well.
Mm-hmm.
So all around, even on social media.
Mm-hmm. And I know that you're hired for your talent. I know
there are
persons who seek you out to, like you said, you mentioned tributes at weddings.
Yes.
And then you go and create and craft
a
particular piece for that event.
That's correct. I wish I had brought one or two of them. I remember these individuals, their relative had passed on, mm-hmm. and they told me that they wanted to do a custom-made piece. So I tell them, I say, okay, give me some information about your loved one. Tell me whatever, where they were born, raised, you know, like the obituary, and we have that.
Yes.
So the piece where they'll have that, as I knew the individual or whatever, it was engrafted. I would have written a piece based on what they would have told me.
Mm-hmm.
When they were born, when they passed on, how many grandchildren they had, and what they did in their life. I mean, it was all done in poetic form.
Yes.
You mm-hmm. understand? And there were times where they invite me to recite it as well. So yes, that is something I do. So those of you under the sound of my voice, if you want a piece done, I don't care what the topic is, put me to the challenge. I got you.
I'm ready to hear next one. Maybe that one you memorized. That we can
okay, good. This one is entitled "Push, Baby, Push." Now this was written many years ago when I had my son in 2001. So you can imagine how many years that is. So it's like 20 years ago or so. I'm going to recite this one. As I sit there in that area of the Princess Margaret Place, big belly in my lap with looks of pain upon my face, I rock from side to side, sitting there on that bench, trying to find some comfort in all that noise and stench. Nurses, them discussing soaps they watched the day before. Haitian mommy screaming, Paggy, Paggy, Paggy! No, can't take no pain no more. I look around in that place to see who all was in the room. About 10 of ye expecting, and a janitor with a broom. 3 Haitian mommies, 6 Bahamians, and a mix. We all was waiting in line to let the doctor fix. No time for chit-chat. We in some serious pain. Don't care for no kind of noise. Judge the latter rain. Waiting patiently on my baby. Feeling the pain within. One thing for sure, I was glad that I didn't conceive in sin. 'Cause one of them patients, man, she was just a child. Them nurses do she so bad and made she very vile. I feel so sorry for she, but there was nothing that I could do but endure my pain by myself and hope I pull this through. I see the doctor dashing with the pencil punny ears, examine the patient cross from me. She was but 20 years. She baby was a pushing, 'cause we all could see the head. The nurses come a running to put she in one bed. In another room was a doctor who was working on his big moat. She was screaming off from she lungs, man, get this baby out! Time goes by slowly as the 10 reached down to 8. Baby moving inside of me, Lord, just give me faith. I will cry so badly, so I let them tears run down. No time for dignity, I didn't care who was looking round. The bench is so uncomfortable, so I walk around a bit, hoping that it would ease my pain, but Lord, I better sit. Moanings, groanings, and screaming is all that we could hear. Mommy and she neighbor, then halfway off the chair. The nurse dashed in to help the 2 who was now on the floor, then dilated 8 centimeters, maybe even more. So one by one they go, and the room is getting clear. I hear one nurse whisper, she could be back next year.
See, this is what I know you for. This type of poetry where you listen and you've experienced it as you speak, right? Mm-hmm. And I know, and the text line light up right after that saying congrats, and who is this lady? This is Lady Miller, actually,
yes,
who is
on at your service, Lady Miller.
Who is speaking now and reciting some poetry. But these are called performative poetry that you're doing. And this is where the storytelling comes in, right?
Yes, that's great.
And but why you took the storytelling path? Why did you decide to do that?
Well, Mr. Newry, I've always okay. Let me just tell you straight up. I grew up with a grandmother and an aunt, especially my grand aunt. Lord, God rest her soul. Ellen Adley is her name. Inet Ellen Adley. Listen, every time I go by Annie, she was there to tell me a story. And I would just be listening, just sitting down listening. I want to hear what Annie has to say. And I would be there, I mean, just gobbling up. I remember one time, even after I would have gotten married, and I just go on the hill, like, hey, Annie, how you doing? Yeah, listen, me and I was on a porch. We sat on that porch from, I see, 7 p.m. We didn't realize. I mean, we just sitting there and talking. She tell me about the stories about her grandmother and how on the island days, or when Mama sent them to the store, Mama say, listen here, I got spit on this ground. Time as I finish spitting on this ground, your backside better be back here before the spit dry up. And she say, listen here, we had to walk 10 miles. So they had to walk these far distance, but they had to be back. Time as the spit dry up. Otherwise, else, they backside going to get cut. So she would tell me these stories. That particular night, I remember, we didn't stop talking till 2 a.m. I was like, Lord, no more. I ain't trouble with my husband now, because 2 a.m., what married woman going on 2 a.m.? And I didn't even call him or nothing. I was just so lost in time with these stories, man, he was sharing with me. You understand? Mm-hmm. And of course, well, thank God he's an understanding husband. He didn't think I was juicing the one on the side.
Lord have mercy.
But yeah, so that's where it come from. Aunts and grandmothers,
yes,
and the old folks. And from a child, Mr. Newry, this is the thing about it.
So this is definitely a heritage for you.
Yes, I always used to be fascinated about being in the presence of older people.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so as a teenager, I used to go to the old folks' home, one of them called Unity House. I'd go there and I'd comb the old people's hair, you understand, just sit and just talk with them. You understand, free of charge, just being in their presence. They'll mm-hmm. tell me, oh, my daughter is so and so. I want to hear stories. So mm-hmm. I always had a fascination for stories, even up to this day. And so what I realized that since it impacted me in that way, I want to spread it and share it with others so mm-hmm. that they too can be impacted in a positive way.
I have a text here asking your name again. It's Lady Miller. And they want to hear another story piece from you. So I give you whatever you have there again.
Okay.
They want to hear one similar.
Okay, well, this
or,
one...
Or story-oriented one, I guess.
Okay. Well, this will be a second piece that I'm going to share that is story-oriented as well. It's a piece. And after that, I'll just share some stories after that, okay? After this one. So this one is entitled The Mechanic. Now, I would have said that... let me read it first. The Mechanic. Mama done called the mechanic man to come and fix we car. Old Betsy sitting in the garage for more than 3 months now. Mechanic man be at me home more than I could count. And for some strange reason, he never charged mama no amount. I come home early one day. He was stretchered in the chair. Anger rushing through my veins because he was supposed to be there. Mama come dashing from she room, all dressed down in red. Smelling like some flower shop, she had petals crossed she bed. Mechanic man jumped he feet, not a word he say. Mama sent me to my room, say I must go and play. I didn't like what I was feeling. Something was really wrong. Blood boiling in my veins, papa taking mighty long. Say, but 2 hours later, I see my pa coming home. Tired from me hard day's work, gone straight there to his room. When he realized what was going on, Pa most catch heart attack. Cause the only thing he see was the mechanic greasy back. As he ran for his shotgun, there was no bullet in. But one by one he load she up, then the fight begin. Mechanic man grab his clothes, dashing for the door. Pa lick off his first shot, missing him by man in Chomo. As he him free running legs, mama grab a holy hand. Pa, it went to the left, causing to Mr. Mechanic Man. He was sweating droplets of blood, thought he was dead for sure. He lift his hand and say, Lord, I swear, I ain't gonna do this thing no more. Pa shoot that gun again, grazing him by an inch. He knew for sure that the next one, he was gonna feel a pinch. But Mechanic Man drive off in his car, never ever looking back. Forgetting that old Betsy still needed fixing inside we shack. Pa never mentioned to Ma about that incident at all, but he left them bullets as is embedded inside the wall. He say it's for remembrance so that Ma would always know that he there is a real man, not some kind of puppy show. Well, Mama learned she lesson, and Pa let off his steam. As Mama think that to yourself, boy, I tell you a long time, two could play this game. Thank you very much.
And I have a texter saying that this is what I need to hear every day, meaning you, right, in your recitation. And I'm reminded of my stepfather who would have said that as part of his learning in the 40s, that poetry and recitation, I think that's really how you pronounced it.
Recitation, that's correct.
Yes, was part of their learning process.
Yes,
that
yes.
Kids, children inside his age group would mm-hmm. have to memorize poems and perform it for the school, right?
Yes.
And I don't see that anymore.
No, you don't see it no more. My grandma used to tell me about one, but take the hammer, Jack, and hit it by its head. And something.
While the lion is red.
While the lion's red. Yeah. Something. I'd be like, boy, I wish I could find out what that poem is.
Mind you, it's a song also. And I try to remember.
Man, if you find it, tell me
the gentleman from Cat Island actually put it inside the song. Anyway, hopefully someone will call it. Phil Stubbs, yes. They'll call. But my stepfather recites all of that.
Wow, you
know, he cites the Royal Reader and say, Newry, you don't know how to appreciate education. This is what you need to do to show that you're cultured. And I think that we need to bring that back.
I agree.
Bring reciting poems, bring this oral choral reading back to our educational system where we can sit down and appreciate literature.
Yes, yes.
Appreciate the arts. Yes. And this is what I'm pushing for, and hopefully for this Independence Day celebration, the powers that be can carve out a spot for Bahamian poets and those who do performative poems can perform, and Bahamians can sit down and appreciate and
enjoy it and say,
this is what it is being Bahamian.
Yes.
And I feel the Bahamas in your words. I feel what it is to be Bahamian in your words, because as you tell a story, you tell a story that I have lived.
Yes, well, except this one here, the mechanic. I ain't lived that one.
Go ahead.
I still got my No Juice and Nobody on the side record. 22 years of being my.
But I understand.
This one of those pieces I would have told you. I say, sometimes I just sit in God's presence. He give me the words. Mm-hmm. I was there laughing as he tell me, because my mind was picturing the whole thing, you know? So this one I didn't experience. But a lot of mamas in this country have experiences and is experiencing that particular poem.
And I know that you facilitate a number of groups, whether it's WhatsApp, whether it's Facebook, or even in your yard where you allow young people to perform and act out and do skits to bring back that old talent of yesteryears.
Yes.
Say, okay, y'all do this production and we'll bring the community to come and sit. So tell me about that.
Yes, there's an event I usually have host inside of my neighborhood. Is called Talent Extravaganza, where I set up the mic, because I have a sound system company. Those of you may put that plug inside there if you need, you know, to if you would like to patronize my business.
I see what you're doing.
Anything of the sort, listen, reach out to me, 448-4372.
Not the phone number on the people show, but go ahead.
Well, they'll pardon me. I'm a very lovable person, you know. So what we do is, what I found, especially going through the school system, I find that there's not room for everybody to get on stage, you understand, whether to come and read the word or to come and sing or whether to come to read the scripture. They normally only choose a select few. And sometimes only that select few is chosen every time. So Johnny in the corner always saying, I wonder when teacher could get a chance to pick me. You know, I want to do it too, and I could do it too. But Johnny never gets that opportunity, you understand? However, what I've done is I've created a stage. I set up the mic. I set up the stage, the speaker boxes. I set up everything. All the child needs to do is come, bring your talent. Whatever your gift or your talent is, you come on stage and you perform it. And if you have the guts to go on that stage, I normally have like a treat bag for you, just as an incentive, you know, to encourage them. Say, listen, well done, you know. And so I tell them, I say, well, if you rapping, or if you come with a song, or if you're an artist, you just want to showcase your pieces, you can do that. Or, you know, if you dance, you know, whatever your gift is, God created us, and all of us have a minimum of two gifts inside of us. You understand? A minimum. Mm-hmm. So I tell them, I say, just come. And it's for anybody. Sometimes even adults go up there and perform, you know. So that's what I do inside the neighborhood. And after I'm done, normally what I do is I'll feed them, you understand, free of charge.
You feed them too?
Feed them, and yes. I normally get some people to sponsor and stuff like that. My eldest daughter, she does the cooking. She likes to cook. And we feed them, you understand, and afterwards, you know. And so, yeah, that's what I do. And I believe... as well, that it'll help the children to break the spirit of fear. I don't know if you remember, Mr. Newry, there was a point in your life when you were afraid to be in the front of a mic.
Are you still afraid of being in front of a mic?
You're still afraid of being in the mic.
I just imagine people doing other things and then talk.
What? I still love being in front of a mic. I could be in front of a mic all Jesus' day. That's my home. I become alive when I'm in the back of a mic.
but you, earlier you spoke that sometimes you're commissioned to craft poems for events. Mm-hmm. But do you do any poems about happenstance, things that happen in a moment of time, like something like how Hurricane Dorian happened,
yes,
or the Great Recession happened, or what the lockdown? Do you craft any poems similar to that?
You gotta call me back, because I did one call. I did two during the lockdown. One entitled Miserable Life.
Because it was miserable, eh?
It was miserable.
That's why we had to vote that person out. But anyway, I don't want to go there. But go ahead.
Yeah, I had to vote him out too. And the thing is, I voted him in to get there. I was highly disappointed in that vote.
I blame you for the lockdown.
You can blame me for that.
I want to hear one more poem. I need to hear more poems. I need to hear more poems. What? And if you have anything like event poems inside that repertoire you have there, you can do that.
I bring the wrong book. But nothing happens happens standardly. I think that all things work together for good. Mm-hmm. But I remember the first line for the miserable life. Listen up, Bahamas. I know what you're going through. Lockdown after lockdown, and there's nothing you can do. That's all I remember.
That's all you remember from that. See, that would have been a good one to read right now. That would have been a
you
good one.
You need to invite me back, and I'll come back again.
Yes.
Well, listen.
But I need more. There are people who are WhatsApping me saying they need to hear more. But what else do you have to share with me?
Okay, what else? Okay, like I said, I could share one or two stories. Let me share you one. I'm also a storyteller.
Okay.
Okay, I'm a good storyteller. Okay, so this particular... this particular Sunday. Grammy Anna always say, listen in the church, don't do nothing on Sunday because that's the Lord's day. Well, I find out now the Sabbath is actually on a Saturday. But nevertheless, you got to keep Sunday holy. That's what you should tell us as a child. I don't want you to go. She wants to go nowhere. Just stay right inside the house till Monday coming. Then you could go. So anyway, her sister, which is Ellen Ali, she didn't have that same belief as her. So I used to frequently visit her. It's like my second home. Just going by her on the weekends when there's no school or Easter break. Whenever there was a break, I was by Annie. All right? She was my grandma, but I call her Annie. So Annie didn't have that same belief as her sister did, and I love that. So I remember one time her son, her eldest son, he said, who I want to go to the beach? I said, yeah. I said, Nuri, I was the first one to get inside that car. They had a Volkswagen. I don't remember the Volkswagen. I said, we jump inside that car. It was him, his friend, my uncle, which is his cousin, his sister, a couple of us. We went to the beach. And back in the day, we used to have our own secluded beach out there across the bridge. We used to pay the 25 cents to go over the bridge. And there's this place over PI. Listen, we used to go and enjoy. Well, that ain't it no more. But nevertheless. And so this particular beach, man, it was just us out there. And the other guy, he was like about 2 years older than me. I was about 8 years old. He's about 10. He had bought this float. So him and I, we started taking turns to blow up this float. You know, it took a while, but we got it blown up. It was a long float. While the other ones, they were like teenagers and 21 and stuff. They were old, way old, enjoying themselves. We couldn't swim. So all we had was that float. We playing, you know, in the shallow area like Bahamians normally do. Stay in the shallow area where you can stand up. And that's what we were doing, playing with the float. We were having so much fun splashing the water in each other, you know, and didn't realize that the float had taken us out. It wasn't until there was a point where a voice said in my head, look around. That's all I heard. I said, look around. All of a sudden, I became conscious that we was way out into the deep. As a matter of fact, we were so way out, my cousin was sitting on the sand, and she was like a little ant in the sand. And suddenly I realized, oh my God, I can't swim. I out in the deep. I about to drown. And so when I looked around and I became conscious, the young man, he looked around the same time. He became conscious. And both of us say, oh my God, this float is all we got. And both of us grabbed the float, because we just had a piece of it, you know. And we went to grab onto the float. But he was like older than I am. He jumped up. When he jumped up, he jumped onto the float. And the little piece of the float that I had, I watched it in slow motion when you watch on TV. It came out of my hand slowly, like, no! And listen, there I was. He was safe on the float. And there I was. The only thing I remember, the voice said, call on the name of Jesus. And I said in my head, Jesus, help me. You know, I need some help. And suddenly the voice responded back to me. He said, balance yourself upon the rock. And I responded back in my head, rock? What rock? Suddenly, Mr. Newry, there was this rock that appeared underneath my feet. I tell you not, I kid you not, this happened to me. This is like a miracle out at sea. And I asked, where does rock come from? You know, because we were just playing in the vicinity, there's no rock. So then the voice said in my head, he said, balance yourself on the rock. Now, I know everybody knows about the flamingos, how they stand up on one foot. So there I was in the middle of the ocean, standing up on one foot, on my left foot. And I remember taking my right foot, as I say, where does rock come from? And I started to feel, there was like a small little pinnacle for my 10-year-old feet to fit. And I could feel where the rock was spreading way down into the ocean. Mm-hmm. A big piece of it. As I stretched my foot and feel it, my foot was widening out. It was stretching way down. And I stood there. Now, by that time, my uncle and my cousin, the two older ones who bring us out there, they had realized that we were out in danger to the sea. So they came, and they just quickly came and grabbed us. Each one of them grabbed, one of us. And the first thing they asked me was, girl, how you stand up in the middle ocean like that? So I replied, I say, now we didn't move nowhere. We was right here having this conversation. They just grabbed us. I said, there's a rock right there. So my cousin said, okay, hold on. Let me, because my uncle was holding both of us. Let me go see what she talk about. So he go on and dive down. Now, you didn't have to dive nowhere. Like I say, the rock was right there. There was a huge rock. He go on and dive down. He come back up a couple seconds later, wipe his face. He say, girl, what rock you talking about? I said, mister, what you mean with rock? So my uncle said, I'm here. You hold him. Let me go look. He go on and dive down. Come back up. And he wipe his face. He said, girl, I don't see no rock. I said, yeah, the rock right there is a big, big, big rock what I was standing on. Mr. Newry, the rock disappeared out of the ocean. It's like God only had it there. Just in time, just to keep saving my life.
God is good.
For my uncle and my cousin to come and save me. I kid you not. So anyway, moving, they carried us to safety, and I was grateful. I was 10 years old, like I said. When I turned 17, I gave my heart to the Lord, and I started to talk to him. And he started to, you know, to reveal to me his plans for my life. And he said to me, remember that time when you was 10, and I rescued you? And I said, that happened for true, because as the years went by, it became a distant memory, like just a dream. I don't know if things like that would have happened to you before. I wonder if that happened, you know? And I just so happened to be where my cousin and my uncle, they were there in my vicinity at the time. And I asked him, I say, when I was small, was we to the beach one time? And I was standing the uncle, he said, yeah, man, you were standing up in the middle of the ocean, and then you were saying that there was a, he finished the story for me, you know? Then you say there was a rock there. We go on, and the next one say, we go on dive down twice, and we see no rock. And so God said to me, he said, yeah, that was me. I save your life. I preserve your life for a reason, for a purpose. So I know that I understood for a purpose. You understand what I'm saying? and how God has done it for me. I have no fear in my life. You understand? I go in the most, the ghettoest area or wherever the gangbangers is. Now you talk to the gangbanger. Hey, what you saying? Man, listen, man, God got a calling on your life. What's going on? Mm-hmm. So I know God have me here for a purpose. You understand? And he preserved me. Yeah, but that was a miracle I would have seen at that time.
Definitely, you have a purpose. And I enjoy that story. And it's something, it was a bygone era. Because mm-hmm. I grew up in a time where in primary school, we would have gone on break and the teacher mm-hmm. would have read stories to us or recite stories to us. Mm-hmm. But we're going to take a short break now.
Definitely.
Right? But I'm going to read this text before I go on the break. And the text says, early on in yesteryear, ordinary citizens used to teach. I'm thinking in slavery days, they used to tell stories to children, and that was brought into the schools early on. But in the 60s, a lot of international students were brought in to teach. Then we started the teachers' training college, so they move away from storytelling, concentrating on full academic in school. But yes, in my primary school days, it was a lot of Bookie and Barabi and that sort of thing. But we'll be right back. This is Guardian Radio at AM with C.A. Newry, and we're talking to a storyteller and a poet who is sharing some of our poems with us, and we're enjoying it. We'll be right back after this brief message.
Love the show? Want to give your support? Become a sponsor today. Call 302-2300 for our rates and packages. That's 302-2300. Become a sponsor on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
Always on the go? Missed the show? You can now listen to Guardian Radio talk shows anytime, anywhere on Spotify and YouTube by searching Guardian Radio 96.9 FM or by entering the name of your favorite show. You can also listen by logging on to guardiantalkradio.com and clicking on the podcast tab. Guardian Radio, continuing to provide you with fresh news and smart talk anywhere, anytime, all day.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
And welcome back to Guardian Radio AM with C.A. Newry, and we're here with Lady Miller.
Yes.
And the texter was mentioning Bookie and Barabi.
Mm-hmm.
I know but Bookie and Barabi.
Yes.
Bookie. They, we no longer tell Bookie and Barabi stories in schools anymore.
No, we don't.
That is a bygone past that is gone, dead, finished as a part of our bohemian culture and history.
Yes,
in fact, once upon a time, the Smithsonian said that we had the largest reservoir, I think that's how it, where it is, of collection of stories and myths and stuff like that. But we're slowly losing all of that and being replaced by television and radio,
yes,
not radio. Knowing that our past is and our culture is being diminished. You know, that there's no, it seems to be no longer a place to tell stories. Mm-hmm. To tell stories about Bookie and Barabi and how Bookie was sly and doing all these mischievous things, right? And we need to perhaps go back to that. I'm not sure how we can.
Mm-hmm.
Who would be responsible for ensuring that that happens, that we carve out a space in the schools, carve out a space in the church, that we can have that culture, that bygone culture continue.
Yes. And I guess for this country, it'll be either between the Minister of Education and the Minister of Youth, Sports and Culture. You understand? That's where they come into play, where they sanction these things into the schools, in the school system, you understand? So the children will have that experience. I know they have the National Arts Festival every year, whereas a lot of the school children, they perform.
Mm-hmm.
And there are many poets that come forward because I've been there where would have experienced it. I don't think it suffice. That's only like a once a year thing where children have to come together and prepare for that. I think that there needs to be an ongoing thing. Even when it comes to literature, Mm-hmm. You understand? There should be some Bahamian poets inside there. You know, to teach them us, teach them our culture, what our past was all about. You mm-hmm. understand? And with the dialect.
And with the dialect.
Yes, you know, I remember when I was growing up in high school, I went to Government High, and they had Shakespeare, Thou Art Fairest, and all that stuff. And I remember specifically, this is what caused me to, I say, man, I am tired of these thous and these and stuff. I don't even understand what they said. Why can't this be a Bahamian poem, what I understand with my dialect? Why have to be forced to learn this? Mm-hmm. That's what I remember thinking, you know. I was in 11 or 12th grade at the time. I remember saying to myself, I'm gonna create some poems, some pieces, you understand? And it'll be based with the dialect.
But our dialect is shunned nowadays. We're telling our youth, our children, no, you shouldn't talk like that. Talk this. It's not even the Queen's English now. Speak the King's English. You know, you need to speak standard, and that this dialect thing is diminishing us as a people.
I think that an enemy had done this. But every Bahamian, especially under the sound of my voice, we know who we are. And it's up to us. And I remember I used to do that to my son too. He would be like, Mommy, get them things from there. I said, no, what's the name of the things? On there. I said, no, it's there. And after a while, I said, hold on. What are... Because God said to me, he said, what are you teaching your child? You're teaching your child, you understand, that the when they say the King's English is better than that, than yours. Mind you, the Queen's or King's English, it has its place. But don't come to a point where you want your child to always, you understand, making sure their I's are dotted and the T's are crossed and stuff like that. Because dialogue is not like that. That's a part of us. And if we want to shun it, like you say, then what are you doing? You're trying to bury yourself, your history, you understand, your grandmother, your great-grandmother. You understand, all of your forefathers and what they stood for, the way they spoke. That's nothing to be ashamed of. Me, I'm so proud of my dialect. And ain't nobody, no other culture, nobody could come and tell me otherwise. Mm-hmm. And you ain't gonna make me conform to your way of speaking. You could come and conform to mine. You understand?
I also noticed that you have a voice. You know, that soothing voice, what you want to listen to. Like you, this mama. So go ahead, mama. Tell me about when I was young.
It is a gift.
And it's a gift to have that voice?
Yes, it is. It is a gift. One teacher, she told me, she said, listen, Miss Miller, listen. She said, you were there, because I was performing over by the Ministry of Youth, Sports and Culture or something like that. She said, as you told your story, I was just there standing up, just in awe. She said, I couldn't move. You know, like the dumb there inside the street, and you see the flashing light, and the day I won't move, just stand right there, get it? Mm-hmm. She said, I couldn't move. So she said, your voice just stunned me. I just, you know? Mm-hmm. And I was like, I want more. I said, yeah, it is a gift. Mm-hmm. It's a gift from God.
I have another text here. It said, great show today, Mr. Newry, and guest.
Thank you.
Excellent show and truly Bahamian. We still have organic Bahamians who love our country, people, and culture. Mm-hmm. Congratulations from the mayor of Grand Bahama. And let's see if I have this next text. Let's see. Ironically, my father was a Morse from Chester's, Auckland. As a young man, he taught in school in Auckland.
Awesome.
But I know you have some shorter pieces there.
I do have some shorter pieces.
Yeah, let's hear some of them before we go.
Now, you would have noticed the difference between when I read it off the paper when it come from my heart. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yes, but and there's one more story I wanna share.
I'm not sure I have enough time for the story
because time's gone. Weird love inside. Yep. Okay, perfect. This one is nice and short. Short and sweet. This one is entitled Free Me. And I wrote it somewhere in 2018. Free me from this marriage. I done had enough. Tired of all your verbal abuse. You always talking to me kind of rough. I hate the way you communicate, especially to me. I just want to run away as quickly as could be. You threaten to lay hand on me, whack me with one belt. You tell me that you could lick me so hard that my skin would start to melt. You didn't call all we children and bring shame to me in their face. Being married to you is simply one disgrace. And that's what time I was mad at my husband.
and imagine you reading that right on air. Like imagine you listening right now and said, this woman? Go ahead. Read one more.
I don't make up since then. You just get mad at your husband, but you still love him after
this. Why stay mad at me? But go ahead.
Okay. Oh, that's a continuation of it. Okay, fine. Let me finish it. Okay. Okay, now. you seldom just give me money. So I could go spend it to the store. And if you give me money, you say, don't ask me for no more. I watch the way you treat one another with love and tender care. But when it comes down to me, you give me one angry stare. Everybody think that you so wonderful because you show them that pleasant smile. But when come time to handle me, you talk to me like one child. I tell you that it over and over that you say you ain't know what I talking about. You act like you get amnesia, forgetting how you go on and shout. I done had enough of this marriage just between you and me. First chance I get out of here, I can take some time. I want to be free.
And married people go through that all the time.
All the time. Listen.
And many cannot express them that feeling, that emotion in words.
Yes.
And
there's
sometimes we need to laugh at ourselves too and say, remember this time?
Yes, you know? Yes, yes.
So I'm sure there are a number of women and men who can appreciate that poem and say, hey.
Sometimes you just want, man, shucks, what am I married for? I used to tell him, I'm sorry for the woman who married you. He'd tell me, I'm sorry for the man who married you. That's before we got married. You know, grandma, she's looking at and saying, ha-ha, y'all two can marry each other.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
There are times I love him.
I tell my wife, I'm going to go sleep in the front room because I wouldn't deal with this. but I understand that.
I just love him. I tell him, I say, God, put a love in my heart for you because I ain't going nowhere. Just get that in your head. Don't come saying, oh, you must have divorced me. I ain't going nowhere.
Mm-hmm.
Get it in your head, okay? You got to be the one to leave.
Upcoming projects. Do you plan to write anything for the Independence Day celebration?
Yes, I actually intend to write a few pieces for the upcoming celebration. And I would that they open up, you know, like you say, have a stage for the poets to come and to share, you know, understand on our culture. Because, listen, this is a gift, and it needs to be shared with
It needs
others,
to be shared.
You understand?
But I don't want to interrupt, but I have a caller here, and I want to pass him through before we over. Go ahead, caller.
Yeah, good morning, Mr. Newry.
Good morning. How you doing?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like the lady and what she's doing, but I wanted to know, like, I was interested, like, I was impressed with what she's saying with getting the Cayman poetry into the schools, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so I was wondering, you know, I think Ali could give you my contact. I really would like to speak with you because do they have something like a platform? Like, I was thinking about something like realitypoems.com. I'm basically just saying reality poems, like how you talk about marriage, but then we could incorporate our history and teaching the young by just writing poetry. Like, you know, because my teacher at COB, she was a Jamaican lady, and she turned me on to V.S. Naipaul and Roger Mayers from back in the days. And so I realized that a lot of African history was hidden in the poetry.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe we could do the same thing here. But that's the only way for us to express ourselves. Because I'm telling you, I would really like to write one or two and just let you look at them. Because I don't know if there's a website, but I was thinking about doing it, realitypoems.com. That's what I'm really into. In a historical context, reality poems I'm interested in. Only reality poems I'm interested in.
52, that's excellent, actually. Brilliant idea. Leave your number with the producer, and I'll pass it on to Miss Miller.
All right.
And that she can communicate with you.
Yeah, because, I like to put something out there and just, you know.
Okay, thanks very much.
Yeah, all
right. Yes, and we're talking about you saying that you're planning to create some poems for the 50th anniversary,
mm-hmm.
and we're hoping that the powers that be, Miss Lesia Miller, who's in charge of this 50th anniversary, invite poets to participate, to be involved, to invite storytellers to be involved in this celebration.
Yes, because I totally agree. There are many poets out there. Trust me. I go by Studio Cafe all the time, and they have good functions and stuff like that. You sit down and just enjoy the moment, you understand, while the poets go on stage and express themselves. And when it comes to poetry, that's a good avenue to express yourself, put pen to paper, you understand, and just share. And sometimes I remember when I was writing, I know you're going to be wrapping
up. No, we're good. Go ahead. We have two minutes.
Okay. So I remember sometimes when I was writing, I had to think, oh, no, I can't write that. But write it. I'm just talking to a poet right now. Listen, just write it. I don't care how bad, how disgusting, how evil, how angry you may be. Write it. That may be a masterpiece that makes you a billionaire. You understand? And I encourage every poet or whatever gift your area is, I encourage you to continue to pursue that thing. You understand? Do that. Run after it with everything that is in you. And you watch God open some doors for you.
And how can people find you? Find you on Facebook?
Yeah. Well, yes, I'm on Facebook, Mrs. Franklin Miller. I'm also on TikTok at Lady Miller 1242. And you can also contact me at 448-4372.
Give me the number again.
448-4372.
This has been Guardian Radio in the AM, and we're talking to Lady Miller with her poetry and what she's doing in storytelling. And I enjoyed the show. This is True True Bohemian just now. Have a wonderful day.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.